everyone, welcome to the episode 18 of Creative Writers and Illustrators. And my guest for the day is Nandita Rakana. She has written three books. And her latest creation is Magic in My Fingers from Karadi Tales. So let's find out more. So Nandita, hello.
Hi, thanks for having me here today, Shyamala.
So I was pleasantly surprised by the choice of your instrument for this book. Okay, because you are a trained pianist from the, from the Trinity School of Music, and yet you chose the sitar. So what captivated you about this story? Where did you find this story? Tell us more about it.
Thanks, Shyamala. So I think as a musician in general, this story was very loosely based on an incident in the life of Annapurna Devi. And like you said, she was a very legendary sitar and surbahar player. So as a musician, there was so much in her life that was inspiring and fascinating. I think as a musician and even beyond, there really were so many facets to how she discovered her musical talent. How she nurtured it in quite difficult times. We're talking about, a century ago, and in a small town of Mehar, her father was a court musician for the Maharaja of Mehar. And it was a time when, the family traditions passed on to the boys in the family and so on. So to do what she did in those times, the way she nurtured her talent, discovered and nurtured her talent, it's very inspiring. She thought herself equal to anyone, male or female, and she was dedicated to her art. You were talking of a specific instrument, but when I read about her and I dived deeper into her life, for example, and I found out how she, her instrument, her music was the end point. It was all about the music being so devotional and almost meditational, inspiring. It was not about performance. And I think there are such wonderful takeaways for these times, when we look at how she viewed her performance and art in general, and how pure and inspiring that thought was.
What do you think children should take away from this book? For me, the sibling bonding came out strong. But I'm sure that was not your intention at all. Your intention was to put spotlight on
There are so many facets. I don't think I set out to, drive home one point or one theme. As you rightly said, the sibling relationship, the father-daughter relationship, Baba was her teacher and her father and a towering personality in her life. All these relationships set in the context of how she, like I said, proved herself and her family that hers was a talent worth exploring. Baba at that stage was only training her brother. But after the incident which we explore in my book, everything changed and her talent was there. It was just there for everyone to see. So it was also to show us that gender matters much less than we think. Anyone can do it if you have that talent inside you and following that passion. So many facets, really. But the family relationships were very much something that the children really relate to, whenever my early reader, even now when children read that. On Father's Day, so many children wrote to me, because they really loved exploring that aspect of it, the naughty sibling, one sibling trying to cover up for the other one. And in the backdrop of that, a father who's a strict disciplinarian and yet, the hero in her life, all of those dynamics, it was lovely to explore.
So there's a tiny note at the end of the book which says that her father caught her correcting her brother.
Yeah.
Right? And that's how, that's the moment when he kind of decided that he's going to train her. So where does this story fit into that part of that reality?
Yeah. So what I wanted to do was a little different from a picture book biography, which perhaps takes you through from beginning to end of someone's life as an inspirational figure and so on. I wanted this to be more of a fictional retelling, an imagined retelling But definitely based on something that children can read about, that, like you said, at the end of the book, there's a note actually on her life and on this moment. Because my idea was, if you take that single moment and imagine how, you know, it at that stage is just imagination of how it must have felt like at that stage to be a girl in that age, in that house with all the dynamics and all that talent inside you. And weave a story around it. So the children actually get immersed in it almost as if it were a fictional tale of another girl. And, you know, I brought in other stuff, you know, but I've tried to stay very true to the person she is.
Yes.
But weave a lot of story around that particular incident. So then, if, you know, the child gets immersed in that moment, in that single incident, which was the turning point in her life. And so there are some dramatic elements that, you know, I've added on to give it that flavor, you know, because it is fiction, like you said. But in the real incident, she sang flawlessly, correcting, you know, a particular part of the piece that he was playing. So there are slight differences, of course. It is just a fictional imagining.
So Annapurna Devi was completely, totally devoted to music, and she is not the kind of a flamboyant personality at all, you know, extremely private person. So was it easy to do research on her?
It was difficult. There are very few of her performances available. She, like you said, she didn't perform in public. Even in the few performances, she didn't allow herself to be recorded. There's very little. There was an authorized biography of hers, and a lot of anecdotal tales about her life as she grew up and so on. So whatever research I could do, speaking to certain musicians at that time, reading about the life of Baba Alauddin, and there was so much around that, and music and Mehar at that time, because the research had various facets to it, about, you know, music, the kingdom at that time, all of that. And it took some amount of time, some amount of digging out different formats, yes.
So what kind of student were you, like, you know, in your childhood? Like, did you run away when it was time to take lessons? Your mom is a music teacher, so I'm assuming that was she your first teacher?
My mom was my first teacher. She's now teaching my children.
Oh, okay.
Yes. I don't think I would have been allowed to run away. My mother was a disciplinarian who very unlike Baba Alola. There was music in our house all the time. There was music in our house all the time. And everyone was making music. And even as I grew up, there were bands. And then there were, you know, competitions, choirs. We were involved in music in some way or the other. And it wasn't something that we wanted to run away from. It just was in our blood and we loved it. Even now, you know, that's so amazing. After a while, I must say, I've gone back to the piano in these times, you know, when you're spending so much time at home. I find that something that gives me so much joy is when I go back to my music, when I sit at my piano. And I think I've spent more time in this past year on the piano than I have in the last several years.
Right.
And I thank my mother, and I thank those early years of practice. You get the picture.
I think ultimately you learn to love the instrument because you specialized, you know, in playing the piano. Right? I mean, that doesn't happen to everyone. You know, it's only when you're truly focused and dedicated to the craft that you can get a degree from the college of opportunity.
Discipline, practice, there's no running away from that.
Right. So, at the beginning of the book, there is a mention that, you know, another main character, Ruhi, is interested in the kite flying festival, and that kind of explains why she's, you know, very particular about trying to get her brother to practice. But there's no mention at the end. Of course, there is a connection. You know, we convey a message through the pigeons soaring. But in real life, what happened? Did she ever get to fly that kite?
So what I think I was trying, they were very fond of flying kites. Both she and I am would do that together. But this is one bit that is fictional, the contest and the competition. The idea was to convey how much she really wanted Baba's appreciation in one way at the beginning of the book. And actually she ultimately fulfills what she wants, but in another way, which is interesting and how that evolves.
Right.
He talks of, we will take you to the market tomorrow, but in her mind, suddenly that's not as important because she got the appreciation she wanted.
Right, absolutely. So there's another book of yours, The Miracle on Sundarbagh Street, and which has got raving reviews, and it's like I've seen it appear on so many lists when it comes to talking, when you talk about books around nature. Right? So what's the book about?
So The Miracle on Sundarbagh Street is about this girl, Zara. And she's at a very low point in her life, Shyamala, you know. So she goes to this dump yard every day, which is somewhere near her house, and she sits there alone. And into her life comes her old art and craft teacher, Miss Guppy. And then a relationship evolves between them, and her trust begins to develop in, you know, with her. And the old lady plants an idea into Zara's head that why don't we transform this old dump yard into something that it once used to be. And so this is the story of that whole transformation of that, you know, old plot, that old space, and how all the challenges they faced, how they got through it. And through that process, how Zara transforms herself, actually. It's a story about community action, because, you know, the whole community on Sundarbagh Street really gets together and makes this happen. The idea came from one girl and one lady, but, you know, took a community to make that happen. And, you know, you're I'm so amazed. This book came, I mean, it's almost a year since it came out. And even now, I get so much feedback from children, educators, about how they connect with, you know, the story relating to environment, recycling.
Yes.
How we, somewhere, the fact that the story is set in the middle of an urban concrete jungle, Mumbai. Yeah. It's about how you can find your own green wherever you are, you know, create that space and do that together.
It strikes a chord. And I think Priya Kurian has done an amazing job with the blending of illustrations. You know, I mean, it's awesome. It's simply awesome.
Okay. I mean, she adds, I think, a whole another level of depth. And she's used the entire, you know, this mixed media illustrations, which, you know, they really just bring it alive. And they blend in so well with some of the themes of the story. You know, like I said, recycling and using what we have. Her entire depiction of Miss Guppy, beautiful. Absolutely. I remember when I first saw them, I was absolutely amazed.
So you've dedicated the book to all the green thumbs behind Bandra's Dream Grove. So it looks like it's inspired by a real incident. And you grew up in Bandra, or you're staying in Bandra?
I'm in Bandra since the last 10 years or so. Since marriage, and actually it is very much based on a true life story. The characters are fictional, but the setting of the story is based around, you know, there is this old plot of land about two roads away from where I live. And it was a BMC plot, so it wasn't really being taken care of. There were, you know, bad events coming there at night, and it was, you know, just left. And it was just opposite my children's library. So when I used to go there, I think by the time I found it, I already saw that there was some activity taking place over there. They were asking for volunteers for Dream Grove. So very cute. And I found out more about it. It's really that. It's a group of people who have come, ordinary citizens, locals, residents of the roads, and a few parallel roads nearby, who've transformed this plot into something very beautiful. It's like a urban farm, food farm, as they call it. Patch of light in the middle of Bombay's concrete jungle. And it was not without its challenges. There are many parallels between their story and, you know, the story, the kind of challenges they faced. The soil was hard, and, you know, how they had to go about that. Getting permissions, of course, was on another level. But today, the miracles I spoke about are true, because the most beautiful part, and they still meet every weekend, they get together and they meet. The miracle is about how this it's brought them all together. Or their celebrations are held there, they share the produce, they share the trees, they've become a really tight-knit community that so that Dream Grove has sort of given them over a period of time. And that was quite an amazing story, they, you know, to read about. And they've got a beautiful page, a blog, where they write about all their regular experiences, young and old. My children's age, a lot of kids, many of people. So all of that that I put together and created as a backdrop for this story.
Right, okay. So this is a book, it's a chapter, no, it's not a chapter book. It's a book for 8-year-olds, 6 to 8?
Emerging readers, yes. It is more wordy than a picture book for younger children.
Right.
It's heavily illustrated. So they've put in the category of 6+.
So at the time of writing the book, you had 80 pots in your house. What's the count now after the lockdown? Has it grown? Has it reduced? What's the status? Have you turned into a green thumb?
No, I enjoy gardening. I really do. Mm-hmm. Another major relief during this time when we are homebound. But really, it's all about that. It's how do we create things of beauty in the, you know, even in the spaces that we have. Mm-hmm. And I find that the closest that I can come to in a state of flow, you know, besides when I'm writing, is actually when I'm gardening. I don't know where the time goes. We don't keep a gardener or anything. I do it myself, and it's a wonderful feeling. It's a wonderful feeling. And I have that awakening happening even in Zara in my story, but it's very heartfelt.
So there's something I observed in all, something common in 3 books of yours, you know, it's the bonding between father and daughter. The mothers are missing, right? So is that, how does that happen? I mean, is it a pure coincidence, or is it, these stories have to be told in this fashion?
Yeah, well, for example, Annapurna's Devi story was all about, I was making it true to life. So naturally, there was a relationship between her and Baba. And I don't think this was a conscious, that's an interesting observation that you have shared. I realized myself on Father's Day, when I suddenly found all my books.
On Father's Day, yeah. It could be a manifestation of the father-daughter bonding.
Just like Papa as a book about fathers and daughters, and Annapurna Devi's book was one about music, and Sundarbagh was environment, and yet all of them were talking about these as books to do it. And I realized that last month, which was interesting.
So not many books explore the love between a father and a daughter. You know, mostly you have a mother and son, mother and daughter, their grandparents. But here it's like the focus is entirely on fathers and daughters.
There are a few books coming up for mine, hopefully this year, which balance the...
Okay. No, I'm not saying that it's wrong or right. You know, it's like you have to find the best way to tell your story. If you think this is the best way to tell the story, then yes, why not? You know, nobody's complaining, right? The readers are going to have a good time. So, yeah. So the third book, which I missed talking about, is Just Like Papa, which is again a recent release of yours from Tota Books.
You know, all three I've released in this last year. October was when Sundarbagh and Just Like Papa released within a week of each other, actually. Mm-hmm. And that was released this year. Quite amazed at the efforts of publishers to bring out books in these times.
Yes, absolutely. I found a very interesting observation in your dedication in this book. It is, may you stay just like yourselves always. It's a very interesting dedication, and I'm curious to know, you know, that is again, when I read the book, I realized it is connected to the book, right? Can you just show a copy of the book to our viewers? Can you bring it closer?
Like Papa?
Yes. It's got beautiful illustrations by Shreya Sen.
Lovely. She's got these watercolor illustrations.
Yeah.
Very, very dreamy, lovely ones.
Nice. So how did you think of telling this story? Was it something, was it an interesting observation as a parent, or was it something which captured your attention?
It would be a product of our current times, you know, just like Papa's about this girl Gia, and she's very talented and she knows it. And everyone sort of has put her up on a pedestal, you know, she's a genius who can do nothing wrong. And all of a sudden, and if there's one thing she always really wanted, it was to be a famous artist like her father. That's the way she imagined that she would be. And what she finds is when she actually picks up a brush and tries to paint, it's not the way she imagined it. What she sees on the canvas is not a perfect rendition of what Gia the perfectionist would like to see. And she's frustrated because this is her first failure. This is the first time she's not been able to excel at what she wanted. And nowadays, you know, I see a lot of children, and I don't even know if I should say parents, but children putting a lot of pressure on themselves to be good at everything. And you can't be good at everything.
Yes.
And I saw this happening at a very young age. You know, my girls are now 8 and 10, but at the time this book sort of got out, they were pretty much the age of young Gia here. And I saw this happening at such a young age, you know. Children, parents talking about how, you know, try and you will succeed. And that's a very noble thought to, you know, encourage children. But what if you don't succeed? What if something is not for you? Does that make you any less? Or does it just mean that, you know, there is some other part of you that you need to explore to find, you know, where you lie, where the real you is, and so on. So I think it really came out of my observations of children at that age. As a young, you know, as a new parent and seeing children in this whole pre-primary school and, you know.
For me, it was, you know, the message, what I took, you know, was that you don't need to fill the molds created by others, you know, and creativity, there are different ways to express creativity, you know, there is no one path. It's just that you've got to be, you shouldn't be harsh on yourself and have the courage to explore it, right? On your own terms, in your own way, and you need to have a conducive environment for that. So I thought it's a very important message which parents and children need to know and understand. You know, right? The roots have to be laid right from the beginning.
You've got the essence of it, Shyam. Even when we do, I've done some school sessions with this book. We've spoken about, we've done quizzes on famous failures because it's important to know that failure isn't the end, actually. It's just, you know, so many famous people moved on to a different path altogether or failed initially and then, you know, people were rejected and then got accepted in the fields that they were in and so on. It was an eye-opener for many people to know that someone like a J.K. Rowling may have been rejected. That many examples that we took, it was an eye-opener because people always talk about successes.
Yes.
You know, inspirational stories and where we should head. And it causes a sort of tension or pressure when you talk about how, you know, if you've not done so well, then how do you report it to the world? So we spoke about growth mindset. Mm-hmm. And it's very nice to know that a lot of schools are exploring topics such as these also, you know, there are sessions dealing with stress or growth mindset and how you view failures as, you know, something that teaches us in life that might show us the way, as a matter of fact.
Yes.
So on. So this is a book that sparks a lot of interesting conversations.
Absolutely. Yes.
That happened at that stage, you know, there's a girl who, for example, I mean, if I may just share, who was talking about how, you know, all her friends were swimming and she was not able to learn swimming at that point of time. And everyone said, but everyone swims, you know, you will swim again, try and try. And you will succeed. But what if it just wasn't for her, or at that point of time it wasn't for her, you know? So she just felt good to know that, you know, you can take up what you think you know, you relate to, or you may do better at, and each one finds their own way in life, you know. Everyone doesn't have to be fantastic at everything. Unrealistic sort of pressures that there are.
So how did you get into the field of writing? You are a consultant. You passed out from XLRI and you've been in the corporate world for so many years, and then suddenly you made this transition into writing. I mean, of course, I think there's creativity in both professions.
I wrote this book in 2005 or 2006, I think. This was my first The Magic of Maya. And
it's
I really
Is it a middle grade or young adult?
No, this is a middle grade.
Okay.
Okay. Fantasy novel. And this was, you know, just when I was starting on corporate life and one still had some amount of time to do something like writing. And then beyond a couple of years, you know, I think I just somewhere got completely, should I say, sucked into the corporate life and the life of a management consultant. There's a lot of traveling and there was no time to write. But after I had my girls, but after my second, I took what I thought would then be a sabbatical. So I took a year or two off, and the idea was to spend more time with them during those wonderful years when they grow up. And I found myself going back to writing because I suddenly found I had the luxury of time after a long time. And I wrote a couple of stories that included, I think, Sunil Bagh at that time and a couple others. And I thought, why not? You know, I was still seeing it as a hobby. Why not send it out? And then the responses were so encouraging from publishers. Now I'm pretty clear that, you know, the sabbatical isn't a sabbatical anymore. I'm not an ex-consultant, currently a children's author. It's something I want to do. I'm very clear on that.
So, you know, I love the diverse topics you have chosen. Is that a conscious way of expressing your choices, or it's just like, you know, you just write what comes to your head and what appeals to you at that moment?
I think a beautiful part of writing and why I write is because, you know, there's a part of you in every book, you know.
Yes.
It is not you as the character or your story, no, not that. But, you know, you see the world, your thoughts, your some things you like to share with others. It's amazing that you can put a part of you in the book and so many will read it and you know, share what they think about it. So, you know, yeah, the themes are not repetitive. And even going forward, I have some others which are completely different fields. But there are some things which, like you said, you know, family relationships, nature, music. There are some underlying themes that I find myself going back to. But the stories, the context, the settings, I try and vary these because even for my interest as a writer, it's to explore new topics. And I don't mind of diving into areas I don't know as much about. I might know a lot about music and family relationship, but like you said, the sitar and subahar and the life of Annapurna Devi were all fairly new subjects to me. I just found it and began a whole process of research and digging layers which I could bring out in the story. So since I'm as a consultant, I think I bring that in to my writing, you know, looking at new areas, you know, not being afraid to deep dive and research into them. And then I learn so much more through the process as well.
Yes, 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 yes. Brilliant. So are you enjoying the way your writing career is going? Right now it's more of picture books. I mean, you're catering to the age of 3 to 8.
Yeah.
So are you looking at your forthcoming books? Are they also in the same, for the same category, or are you looking at something higher?
Two chapter books in the works.
Okay.
They're being illustrated at the moment.
Okay, so it looks like as your children grow, the you know, the age level to which the books cater to is also increasing. So yeah, good.
I love picture books. I think my first love.
Absolutely.
You know, I love picture books. In fact, now they are at the stage where, you know, I don't buy their books. You know, they choose their own books from the library, so I can't buy all my picture books in their name still anymore. I continuously do. I'm such a fan of picture books.
Okay. Thank you so much, Nandita. Is there, I think you should take each of your books and talk about them quickly.
Absolutely, sure.
Yeah.
Tell
us, you know, who should be buying it and what will they be, you know, enjoying when they read the book.
So this is The Miracle on Sundar Bagh Street, and it's been illustrated by Priya Kurian, published by Kalpavriksh, which is actually an NGO that does a lot of fantastic environmental work. And what they saw in the story was that it really nurtures a love for the environment around us, for those who love green and nature. And it's a story of transformation. There's a lovely miracle that happens in it, but there are big and small miracles that we can spot through the book. So if you know, you like nature, you like here. I'm going to give you some of the samples because I think that's another reason that you really need to look at this book. It's Priya Kurian's lovely illustration.
Yes, yes, yes. Right.
This is a story of positivity and hope. So that's something that you can look for. And the second one, which was just like Papa, we just spoke about that. So Miracle of Sundar Bagh Street was for children, perhaps 7 or 8 plus. But this is for a slightly younger age group, even 5 plus. So just like Papa. And there's this girl, Jia, who wanted to be just like her father. And she found another way to do that. She found that she wasn't successful in her first attempt, but failure is a part of life. Again, you should read this if you just love to read a story about a lovely father-daughter relationship. There's a lovely bonding that happens between them. That's them doing some masti in his art studio. It's a story set in Goa, beautiful Goa, where I'm from. So it's a story that explores art and following your passions. That's another theme that I think binds this book and the next one, which I'm going to talk about, which is really following your heart and finding out who you are, staying true to that. And that really brings me to my third book, The Magic in My Fingers. This was written by me and illustrated by Nayantara.
Can you show it? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, good.
By Nayantara, Surendranath, and Kanimoi. And I don't think I've talked much about the illustrations here, but there's...
They're beautiful, absolutely colorful, vibrant.
You know, the flowing style, you know, there's music running through the illustrations as well, I should say. So if you're a fan of music, and again, if you enjoy stories which talk about real life inspiration, because we've spoken a lot about how this was loosely based on the life of Annapurna Devi. There's a note at the end that talks about that as well. A lovely role model for us. Then, you know, this might be an interesting book to pick up as well. All books are available on Amazon, on publisher websites, on independent stores like Funky Rainbow, Kahani Tree in Mumbai. A lot of options.
Yes.
Yes, it's been quite a year.
And, yes. All the best, Nandita. It's been a pleasure having you here. And I'm eagerly looking forward to reading your new books as well. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.